Presented by Church Tech U, it's the ProPresenter Show. On today's show, common ProPresenter mistakes and how to solve them. Hi and welcome again to the ProPresenter Show. This is the show where I teach all about ProPresenter. My name's Paul Alan Clifford. And before we get started, if you wonder if you're making some common mistakes, go ahead and subscribe. Click the little bell icon and maybe even put a list of things that you think you may be doing wrong below the video, and that way maybe I'll address it in a future video as well, or point you to one that already exists. So, in my work running the official ProPresenter users group along with Renewed Vision, I see this all the time, that people will do a few of these things. I've only got three for this particular one, and it'll come back and bite them. Maybe not immediately, but eventually. So let's head over to the computer, and I'm going to show you two of the three, and then we'll discuss the third one. So the first one is, if we go down here. Here, I should just click on it to save time, is right here. Now, it's obvious to me that there's a mistake here. It may not be obvious to you. And that is, you see this little icon. Notice how it's on every single one of the slides. Turns out, every single one of those has a look change on it. So, if I change this to default, and then I click on any one of these slides, notice that that pops up. Here, let me clear that out real quick. But this changed to just default, and clicking on any of those slides would do that. I could see a utility if you never know the order of things. I had a youth pastor that I worked with several years ago, and every time that I would run ProPresenter for him, he'd go, okay, I'm really kind of Middle Eastern in my thinking. Everything is circular. I'll try and telegraph what slide comes up next, but I never know in what order. So in that case, maybe you would want to put look changes in more than one place in case you needed to change stuff on the fly. But in general, this is just making extra work for you. As I set this up, it took me a bit of time because every single one, I right-click, go down to Add Action, go to Audience Look, and then select the appropriate look. So that was a lot of work.
Hey there, aspiring ProPresenter Pro. Are you tired of getting tangled up in tech trouble? Want to impress your congregation with mind-blowing visuals? Well, look no further. Introducing ProPresenter 7 training at Church Tech U, your secret weapon for unlocking ProPresenter's full potential. Join me as I dive into the world of captivating presentations, smooth transitions, and jaw-dropping effects. From beginner basics to advanced tips and tricks, I've got you covered. Don't miss out on this amazing opportunity. Visit churchtechu.com/free trial for a free month now. Did I mention it's free? And revolutionize your ProPresenter game. Your congregation will thank you.
And that was with only 9 slides. Now, granted, this is an arrangement, so the tag actually happened both times. But with that said, you just really don't need to do that. So that's the first thing that I would say, is don't put a look change on every single slide, because when you change the look, it stays that way, or it should. If it doesn't, reach out to support at renewedvision.com and talk to them about it, because it should stay that way. And so you're just making extra work for yourself and not really accomplishing anything. So that's mistake number one. Mistake number two that I often see is, and I did this over in default one right here, and that is, if I go into looks, edit looks, ignore the vertical one because that's this guy and it does not have the slide layer enabled, so there's no alternate look. Even if I put it on there, it wouldn't do anything. So, but all the others have the alternate look, the alternate theme, rather, the alternate theme icon on them. It looks a little different on Windows last I checked, but on macOS, I think this looks like an old-fashioned carpenter's ruler, you know, the one that fan folds. Or someone suggested to me that it's probably paint swatches, like if you get from the hardware store or whatever. So anyway, each of these has this. So you might be wondering, well, what is the downside of having that on all of these? Well, the downside comes when you go in here and let's first I'm going to remove this audience look so that it doesn't change back to regular default. So let's say I decide, oh, these words are a little too big. So I'm going to just make all of them a little bit smaller. So I could go into the editor or up here, I don't talk about this enough, this text area. I can just click the down here and therefore make it smaller. Okay, so now watch this. When I click on this, you would expect that to get smaller, but it didn't. Well, maybe I'm just on the wrong output. So I click on that one, and it didn't. And the main out. That one is showing the other, showing this guy actually. So ignore that. But so these two didn't change it. If I go into edit looks here, yeah, so I disable announcements. Still, it's the bigger size, not the smaller size. So this tends to be a problem when people put alternate looks on all their screens and then they edit something here, not the content. I didn't change the words. It would change which words, you know, if I added an exclamation point after grace and then capitalized H, it would change that. But the fact that I made this one smaller, it did not change. So that's when people get very confused and say, hey, I made this change and nothing happened. 9 times out of 10, maybe 99 out of 100 times, that's the result of doing this exact same thing, having an alternate look on all your screens. So the way I like to think of it is, whatever screen I think of as my primary screen, this is the one that I'm not going to have any alternate looks on. It's going to be what I see here is the way that it's on my primary screen. Any secondary screens, those are the ones with the alternate looks. So that's kind of the way that I think about it. So that's the second mistake that you could make is put alternate looks on, or alternate themes on every single screen in your looks dialog. So that's number two. Now the third one is something that I've seen people do from time to time, and that is that they have done the installation themselves, or maybe they didn't have the best contractor, AV installation contractor. Either way, what I'm about to suggest seems like it would work, but it doesn't, or it will for a time and then it will quit. And what is that? Long HDMI cable runs. Now, think of HDMI as something that is designed for your house, running from an Apple TV, a Blu-ray player, what have you, to your TV. So you're probably not going to have a very long cable. 3 feet, about a meter, that's probably the length. If you're going to stretch it, it's going to be twice that long. If you really, really, really stretch it, maybe 10 times that long. But in a church building, that doesn't even begin to account for the length that you need. You're probably going to need something like 100 feet, 33 meters or so. I'm doing the math in my head. That's probably not exactly accurate. But you're going to want it in the realm of that distance. So that's long. Now, there are special cables that tend to do a better job, but if you just go to your local big box store and buy a 35-foot HDMI cable, and then a coupler, and another one, and couple all those together, if it works at all, because it's digital, it will look perfect. Until it doesn't, and then it'll start blinking. And then if it gets any worse, it will just not work at all. In the analog days, this would be what we call a graceful degradation, where it would get a little fuzzier if it was too long, but you could still use it. That's not the case anymore. With digital, it's either there or not there, and occasionally it'll, like, sometimes be there, but that's really annoying to have it blinking all the time. The change that could be caused, that could cause that, is it could be that there's a little corrosion on one of the ends of the cable. It could be that the computer starts putting out just a little less power or what have you. So though that's something that I would avoid. In my experience, the best solution for this is to take HDMI, convert it to SDI, which is a single coaxial cable, and then at the projector or the display, whatever is at the far end, convert it back to HDMI if it doesn't have an SDI input. So that's, in my experience, the best way to do that. SDI does have a limit as to how far it can run, but the solution to that is you can just put an amplifier midway down and it will amplify the signal and reclock it and everything, and it'll work from there on. So those are the three common problems that I see. The last one isn't technically ProPresenter, it's a wiring problem, but people always blame ProPresenter, even if it's not that ProPresenter itself is the cause. So, just to recap, putting a look change on every single slide, totally unnecessary. Adding an alternate theme on every single screen, also totally unnecessary and could cause some confusion, or trying to run an HDMI cable that's way too long. So those are the three common mistakes I see with running ProPresenter and live video in churches. If you like this content, you'd probably like my ProPresenter 7 Quick Start course. So head on over to tdm.fyi/pro, the number 7, quick. Give me your name and email address, and I'll make a login for you for free instead of the $29 that normally costs. Until next time, this is Paul Alan Clifford from TrinityDigitalMedia.com and ChurchTechU.com, reminding you to go out and change eternity.